Now, can you hear me?
You're good.
Yes.
Okay. The Selma Center was founded just 2 years ago, but we've been having trainings in nonviolence by Dr. Bernard Lafayette. Many of you know of him. He had a center in Connecticut and in Rhode Island, and he started nonviolence trainings in Nigeria and in Colombia, South America, where he was taken hostage, etc. But he has come back to Selma, where he worked in 1962-63 with the people there in the voter registration movement. He was with Dr. King the night before King was killed, and Dr. King said, "Bernard, the next thing we have to do for our movement is to internationalize, institutionalize nonviolence." And that's what he's been doing ever since. I was supposed to get a lot of materials mailed to you, but apparently they did not make it. There may still be a few of the brochures over on the table, but if anybody wants to talk to me about it, excuse me, we'll have our next training in July with Dr. Lafayette leading, and we've had students from Connecticut and from California and Wisconsin, people there on spring break, so check us out on Facebook, on the webpage, and we were really happy to be sponsors, in-kind sponsors of the conference here. Thank you, Bruce. And when I heard about economic conversion, I thought of a song that came to me a long time ago in the 70s. Was it? No, probably early 80s. And it's about Korea. And it's about people all over the world who are not able to get the care and to have the lives they need. The song begins, "I grieve for you, Mrs. Wang, whose husband died in Seoul, Korea. Tuberculosis struck his chest, and he died a bloody death. 'Cause he could not pay, hospitals would not let him in, and souls disappear every day in that way. And your four-year-old daughter wipes away those endless tears, learning early the lessons of death over life. And it's you, Ms. Wang, Ms. Weisner, Ms. Williams, Ms. Watts, in Seoul, Jerusalem, Macon County, and Ellen. Our precious families die, 'cause we cannot pay, and our four-year-old daughters wipe away those endless tears. Learning early the lessons of death, over life. Well, what do they say, oh, what do they say, those who can pay? I'm sorry, but you know where your money has to go. We've got to buy more bombs that you can be secure, large nuclear subs to keep the enemy from your door. Oh, no.
Woo!
That was wonderful. My name's David Swanson. I'm going to be doing the introductions here, and I'm going to add a few words of my own at the end because we have the great misfortune of not having Tarek Kauf with us, who had airplane problems. So we will start with Mary Beth Sullivan, who is a social worker attempting to meet the needs of people experiencing homelessness in a time of diminishing resources, or one might say diverted resources. She is a member of Brunswick, Maine's Peace Works and frequently writes and speaks about conversion of the military-industrial complex. Mary Beth Sullivan.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, all of you. It's wonderful to be in this particular space as we're engaging the conversation about conversion. I just had a conversation with someone who explained to me that there literally was a small cotton field outside of this building some centuries ago. And inside, textiles were built. And it converted from making textiles to making shoes. And then it began to make boots. And the last fabrication that happened in this building were boots that were used in Vietnam, soldiers in Vietnam. So here we are today, how many years later, in a revived creative space, and we have the opportunity to be talking about peace. It's a very fascinating history. So as Dave told you, I'm a social worker. My job and my work is about building relationships. As he explained, I accompany communities of people experiencing homelessness and poverty, people who've been on the losing end of the US budget debates, dominating war profiteers. The debates have been dominated by war profiteers. I have a front row seat to the consequences in a country that has ignored President Eisenhower's warnings to beware of the influences of the military-industrial complex. So Dave talked to us earlier today about a government program that had a very clear goal, full spectrum dominance, lots of planning, and tons of funding. So I ask, this vision for 2020 was put out to the world back in the early 1990s. Here we are, it's almost 2020. Given what you've heard, my question to you all is, how did they do? Have they reached their goal? Full spectrum dominance? I ask my American friends, do you feel any safer? No. How's your health care?
Oh my God.
How many jobs do you need to get by around here? My premise is that the US war economy is a gigantic, unwieldy dinosaur that is weighing us down and holding us back. We've moved into the 21st century, and the Arctic is melting. Global climate change is causing extreme weather events that create chaos and devastation around the world. 2016 was the hottest year on record. This is the issue the 21st century must address if the planet is going to survive. Who coined the phrase, there is no planet B? Back home in Maine, our friends have been writing letters and editorials about this issue for more than a decade. We live in the neighborhood of Bath Iron Works, a factory that's owned by General Dynamics and is currently making exclusively naval destroyers. The peace community frequents that factory to hold signs offering a vision of other products that might be made at BIW. Here is my friend Leanne holding one of the many images that we offer, and she's standing out in front of that particular shipyard. It's become a mainstream issue in our community to have that conversation. How do I know that? Just the other day, we looked at our local newspaper and there's a letter to the editor by someone we didn't know. Now, Maine is a small state. We know the peace community. We know who we talk to day in and day out. This isn't someone who's part of our chorus. He describes that he recently returned from a visit to Scandinavia, where he became acutely aware of the decayed infrastructure in the United States. He was in awe of modern airports, paved roads, devoid of potholes, smooth, quiet, fast electric trains, stations for electric cars to be recharged, plowed wide bike paths beside the highway on a snowy morning, full of people pedaling to work. His Scandinavian friends told him, America seems to be the only country that does not recognize the reality of climate change. So what this gentleman offered in the newspaper, in his letter to the editor, he said, Democrats, Republicans, independents need to work together to demand an honest assessment of America's infrastructure needs, a realistic long view plan for working with a changing climate, and a budget that puts our citizens' needs ahead of the buildup of a vast military and nuclear arsenal that destabilizes the world. We need a 21st century, coast-to-coast, rural and urban transportation system that's fast and efficient. Here's the key. What prevents Bath Iron Works from transitioning from making warship building to building wind turbines? Now that wasn't a mainstream idea 20 years ago in our community. It's beginning to become one now. So this letter tells me that there is a vision out there and that our ideas really are mainstream. So what would economic conversion look like? We have an example in history. During the Second World War, President Roosevelt, by executive order, established a process that took control of the US economy to convert and expand peacetime industries to meet the industrial needs to win the war. Here are some examples. Lingerie factories began making camouflage netting. Baby carriages became field hospitals, field hospital food carts. Lipstick cases became bomb cases. Beer cans went to making hand grenades. Adding machines to automatic pistols and vacuum cleaners to gas mask parts. They say that what made this conversion work was the recognition that there had to be a plan, that the government was behind the plan, and the plan had public support. FDR used his leadership to negotiate a sense of partnership, and that all of us were in this effort together. Now, I am in no way suggesting that the path to conversion is for President Trump to take over the economy by executive fiat. I am suggesting, however, that A, conversion is possible, B, true leadership is needed in this country, and C, that leadership begins in the people's movement. It begins here in this room. There are exciting movements in this country devoted to articulating the impacts of global change. However, the global climate change. However, the elephant that sits in the middle of that conversation is the military-industrial complex. The Pentagon is the organization with the largest environmental footprint in the world. Many are reluctant to take on the military or its budget for fear of political reprisals. The myth is that building the military's infrastructure and its weapon systems creates jobs and that sacred cow can't be touched. But one crucial fact is military spending creates far fewer jobs than if we spend those dollars elsewhere. The Political Economic Research Institute at the University of Massachusetts at Amherst did a study that shows the employment effects of US military and domestic spending priorities. They looked at the impact of devoting $1 billion to the military versus the same amount of money spent on clean energy, healthcare, and education. Their conclusion is straightforward. $1 billion spent on each of the domestic spending priorities will create substantially more jobs within the US economy than with the same $1 billion spent on the military. Here are the numbers overall. $1 billion in military spending gives us 11,200 jobs. The same amount spent on clean energy gives us 16,800 jobs, a 50% increase. Spend it on healthcare, we get over 17,000 jobs, a 54% increase. Spend that money on education, we're bringing in over close to 30,000 jobs, an increase of 138%. This study can be found on the Global Network's website. Given that reality, what would a real jobs program in the US look like? Seymour Melman, who was the most prolific writer about economic conversion, he helped craft a national and local planning structure that could have made conversion a reality after the end of the Cold War, had rough and tumble politics not interfered. In 2003, he wrote an article called In the Grip of a Permanent War Economy, where he told this story. Back in the late 1990s, New York City's transit authority had between $3 and $4 billion to spend to begin replacing its subway cars. City government put out a request for bids. Not a single American company responded. Why? Given its military focus, the US industrial base no longer manufactured what was needed to maintain, improve, or build our infrastructure. Melman complained that industry even lacked the tools to build rail cars. Instead, New York City contracted with companies in Japan and Canada to build its subway cars. Melman estimated that such a contract could have generated, directly and indirectly, about 32,000 jobs in the United States. He envisioned production facilities and a labor force that could deliver 6 new subway cars each week, producing 300 cars a year, and thereby providing new replacement cars in a 20-year cycle for the 6,000 rail car fleet of the New York subway system. Recently, the American Society for Civil Engineers once again gave our country a D+ in evaluating our physical infrastructure, roads, bridges, rail, public transit, schools, drinking water, ports, levees. What if we began to structure how to modernize our crumbling infrastructure with an eye toward zero fossil fuel dependence by 2050? Are we gathering our engineers, scientists, and communities to identify what renewable energy source makes sense in each region and what local industries could be converted to build the products? Could we transform a plant that makes a naval destroyer or a submarine to one that builds light rail cars or commuter trains or wind turbines? Beyond imagining, what can one committed community or even one person do? Let me tell you about our friend Peter Woodruff, who quite recently retired from Bath Iron Works. Devastated by the role BIW made Aegis destroyers played in the shock and awe attack in Baghdad in 2003, Peter eventually outreached us, Bruce and I, and our community, and became a dear friend and teacher. Over the years, Peter did his best to share information about economic conversion with his work colleagues. He once produced a bumper sticker that read, "Save Bath Iron Works, Build Wind Turbines," which became a popular lunch pail decoration. He also created a petition asking for BIW to begin a process to manufacture other products and courageously invited his colleagues to sign it. 800 workers did so. Peter shared the signatures with the editor of the local newspaper, who wrote a memorable editorial recognizing Peter's foresight and acknowledging that there's no safety and security at the shipyard if all of its production eggs come from one military basket. Economic conversion's also been a big focus for our artists in Maine. Maine has an active and vibrant visual arts community. We had a conversation once with the woman who organized the Union of Maine Visual Artists, Natasha Mayers. It took little time for the idea to percolate to create this process. She invited Maine's visual artists to depict images of what conversion might look like. The art exhibit was called Warflowers. We had openings at Student Union in a local public university, and this traveled the state for 2 years. We've spent years organizing hearty friends to the slow, steady, engaging effort of doing peace walks around the state of Maine, with great support from the Japanese Buddhist order Nippon Zamyo Hoji. Next October, we plan to organize a week of walking in and around our city of Bath, Maine. We will leaflet BIW workers as they come and go from work. We will walk some, enjoy potluck dinners with various communities and church groups. We will have open community meetings to share dialogue about economic conversion. We will do everything in our power to keep the conversation about conversion alive. Please come and join us. I just want to share one final thing. Let me ask this. Conversion from a war economy to a peace economy. It's a path to survival for the 21st century. I hope I convinced you of that. I hope you believe it's possible. But I want to end with a message from our friends Mariah Holt and Betty King. Mariah recently finished writing their story of 30 years of activism in opposition to Maine's only nuclear power plant, which actually closed down in 1996. The reasons for the closing are many and complex, and the activists certainly played a role in the process. But a friend of theirs had this to say, quote, "Claiming credit for shutting down the power plant is problematic. It's not the point, really. In the meantime, you're obliged to do everything you can." So this friend quotes a Vietnamese Buddhist monk who was asked during the Vietnam War, "What do you think of the American peace movement?" He answered, We think of drops in a bucket. We drops don't care where in the bucket we fall. But in America, everybody wants to be the last little drop that makes the bucket overflow. Reversing our country's dependence on a war economy is inevitable. Building a sustainable infrastructure in this country must happen if we ever survive. Both efforts require that enough of us choose to be a drop in the conversion bucket, one drop that when it hits causes its own small ripple. May it be. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mary Beth. We now will be privileged to hear from Hyun Lee, who is a member of the Task Force to Stop THAAD in Korea and Militarism in Asia, small goal, and the Pacific. She is also the managing editor of Zoom in Korea, an online resource that you all should check out on peace and democracy in Korea. She lives in, that should say new, I think, she lives in New York. Hyun Lee.
Hi, good afternoon. I've been telling everybody that I've been talking to this afternoon at this conference, and I don't think I'm the best person to talk about strategy, because I feel like many of you in this room have many more years of experience and wisdom to really talk about strategy forward. But what I will talk about today is, one, an assessment of where I think we might be in terms of U.S. policy in the Asia-Pacific region, some immediate tasks vis-a-vis the Korean Peninsula and some appeals for solidarity, and then end by talking about the recent movement in South Korea that ousted the previous president, and to see if there may be any if we can draw from that some inspiration and also some lessons that might be applicable as we think about strategy for our movement here forward. So U.S. policy in the Asia-Pacific region. Well, the last coherent strategy was under the previous Obama administration called the Pivot to Asia, and I'm not going to go into the details of that because I think many of you in this room are very familiar with it. It's had mixed success at the end of Obama's administration. Number one, the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which was supposed to be the mechanism to ensure neoliberal economic order in the region by creating this massive trading bloc that excludes China. It didn't pass. So that was a huge aspect of the Pivot to Asia that didn't come about. Number two, in Southeast Asia, the U.S. was fanning historical territorial disputes between in the South China Sea, between China and its smaller neighboring countries. And the aim was to really turn these countries against China and present the U.S. as a benevolent power that can be sort of a counter power that can protect them against the China, the bully, quote-unquote. But as you know, recently Philippines leader Duterte famously said bye-bye America, and it seems the you know, that strategy of pitting smaller countries in the South China Seas against China is not going the way that the U.S. Wanted. In Northeast Asia, pursuing the trilateral alliance between the U.S., Japan, and South Korea, and getting those two countries to work closely together militarily, particularly in missile defense. That's an important part of U.S. agenda in the region. It wants Japan and South Korea in an alliance led by the U.S. facing off against China and North Korea and Russia. But South Korea will soon have a new leader that may want to chart a different path in the region, and that could be a game changer. So this is the landscape that Trump has inherited. He is also, as you know, mired in his own scandals here at home. So his policy in the region is very unclear. It may become clearer after this weekend, after his summit with Xi. His first foreign policy test in the region clearly is Korea. We now have escalated war threats in Korea. And we in the room should be clear on how we actually got to this moment. And we shouldn't be confused by distortions in the Western corporate media. Many in this room probably know, but many in the United States do not know that the U.S. has maintained the threat of a nuclear first strike against North Korea since the 1950s. From 1958 to 1991, the U.S. had hundreds of nuclear weapons in Korea. In response, North Korea to develop its deterrence capability to create mutual deterrence, what it did was deploy conventional forces near the DMZ. That picture changed with George W. Bush in 2001. There were advancements in weapons technology, a focus on high speed and precision weapons, and also coupled with doctrinal changes that gave the US preemptive strike advantage. He famously called North Korea part of the Axis of Evil. He named North Korea as a part of a list of seven countries that were targets of potential preemptive strike in the Nuclear Posture Review. So then in response, this is really when North Korea seriously turned to develop a new type of deterrence and turned to develop nuclear weapons, and its first nuclear test was in 2006. Now we know that the U.S. and South Korean militaries are developing missile defense capability to try to take out or neutralize North Korea's nuclear weapons and undermine its deterrence capability so that it can have first strike advantage. So now, in response, what North Koreans are doing is they're developing countermeasures that can evade missile defense systems. So the mobile missile launchers, the submarine-based ballistic missiles, and then also simultaneously launching multiple missiles so that the missile defense systems can't hone in on the real target. Missiles that fly in an unpredictable pattern, in a zigzag pattern. These are all of the recent tests that we have seen from North Korea. That's what all of these are about. During the previous Obama administration, while the United States refused to engage North Korea, North Korea has focused on developing its deterrence capability, and now many experts in Washington are saying North Korea will soon have, if it doesn't already have, an intercontinental ballistic missile with a miniaturized warhead that can reach the continental U.S. And this is what Washington is particularly anxious about, and that's its sole focus is to prevent North Korea from test launching an ICBM. And that is the number one priority for the Trump administration in the region at this moment. And so the summit this weekend with Xi may reveal the basic outlines of Trump's policy vis-a-vis North Korea, and then hence the region. How he chooses to deal with the current crisis would be an indicator of his broader approach in the region. It doesn't look good. Today there were news reports that says the Trump administration has finalized its policy review, and it may include redeploying nuclear weapons in South Korea, as well as taking military actions to take out the North Korean leadership. So, some immediate tasks for those of us working on Korea peace issues and some appeals for solidarity. One, immediately in terms of US-DPRK relations, I think the number one task challenge for us is challenging the corporate media distortion on really the history of how we came to this this point. The corporate media likes to paint a picture of North Korea as irrational, crazy, dictatorial country that is a threat to the U.S., but we should be very clear that the threat began with the United States, and what the North Koreans have been doing is developing a deterrence capability to protect itself. And, you know, as peace activists, in principle, of course, we are against all weapon systems, all nuclear tests, and all missile tests. But, you know, we should also recognize that it is the sovereign right of North Korea to test missiles in order to develop a way to defend itself from U.S. threats. I think in terms of media distortion, the recent media portrayal of the assassination of Kim Jong-nam is a good example. You know, what we do, the facts we do know about what happened is that two women were arrested. They turned out to be Indonesian and Vietnamese. There's no evidence connecting them to North Koreans. The only North Korean that was arrested in connection with the incident was released by Malaysian authorities because there was a lack of evidence. VX, the substance that was allegedly used to kill Kim Jong-nam, is apparently the deadliest nerve agent ever created. It is considered a weapon of mass destruction. Chemical weapons experts are now questioning whether that was really involved in the assassination, because it's hard to explain how the two women who allegedly killed him handled that substance and then got away with it without any without suffering any serious damage. So these are the facts that we know, but the South Korean and the Western media continue to say that North Korea was behind the assassination as if it's a verified fact. And then if you repeat it often enough, then it becomes unquestioned narrative in the people's mind. So when it comes to Western media coverage of North Korea, you know, alternative facts have been the order of the day. And we need, especially if the situation in Korea escalates, if the U.S. actually does take military action or decide to deploy nuclear weapons in South Korea, we need the anti-war movement in the U.S. to challenge the media distortion that's put out by the Western media. One resource is a blog that I help to manage. It's called Zoom in Korea. We try to put out alternative narratives about the U.S.-DPRK relations and also keep updating about the struggle that's happening in Korea around the THAAD issue. Also, around the THAAD issue, you know, there is the current moment right now is very urgent, precisely because